Real cool. Here we go. Here you are on the stage, all of you. Right there, getting zapped by that fire. Here, hover that up. Look at this. Here you all are.
I wouldn't do it again.
Oh.
You guys want to give it just a few more minutes?
Yeah, a couple of minutes, yeah.
And I will do a spatial recording of the whole thing as well, so we can get it on video later from a front row camera. There you go, out to the moon, out to the earth.
Thank you, Chris.
Chris, we have access to that video later for people who aren't able to make it tonight?
So there's two ways you can have access. I'll have a spatial recording that you can just plug into the documents, engage my recordings, and actually relive the experience as though you were there. Okay. And I'm also going to put it on just a video and give it to the educators in VR so that they can upload it to their library for access.
Oh, perfect. Thank you.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Absolutely, Carlos. Yes, please. All right. What do you think? Shall we, you guys about ready to get going?
Yeah.
Great. I'm going to give me a sec to get the recording going here. Call this Panos. Okay.
No, no, no worries.
Thank you. I was hoping that was going to happen too. Thank you.
Okay. Hello, everybody.
Hi.
And good evening from UK. Or good morning, actually. It's 1 a.m. here now. First of all, I'd like to thank Daniel and Laurel from Educators in VR because they gave us this option of panels presenting a second time. He has already made one presentation in Old Space VR, and this is a repetition of the same presentation. So I'd like to thank them because not everybody had the same chance. My name is Anna Ksivu. I am the host of this event, and I'm going to present you Panagiotis Kourtesis. He is a PhD candidate and researcher in experimental psychology and cognitive neuroscience at the University of Edinburgh, in collaboration with University Tour Ursula Benincasa of Naples. He affiliates with the Human Cognitive Neuroscience Research Team of the Department of Psychology and the Interdisciplinary Research Center, Siena Nuova. He is a certified virtual reality software developer, VR specialist, and XR workshops coordinator at the UCreate Studio at the University of Edinburgh. His current research interests include VR neuroscience and neuropsychology, VR rehabilitation and therapy, cyber psychology, human-computer interaction, brain-computer interaction, telemedicine, and VR research methods. So tonight he's going to give a presentation on VR research methods in neuroscience and neuropsychology. To you, Panos.
Hi, everybody. I'm glad that you're here. Big thanks to everybody in Educators VR for this great event. Let's start with the presentation. So I'm going to talk about the VR research methods for cognitive neuroscience and neuropsychology. First of all, let's start from what the VR brings to the psychological research. The very first thing is that we can automate the assessment, the rehabilitation, or the training session. And that also give us full control on the testing and the training environment. So that means, because we have this absolute control on the environment, that we can, of course, we can measure almost everything. And also we can create experiments that otherwise wouldn't be feasible. An example is an extreme example is like we can even replicate a version of Milgram's experiment in VR, where we can measure memory under stress or social cognition. Of course, this in the real world wouldn't be ethical. It would be totally unethical. And more other examples. Anyhow, and but in my view, the most important asset that that VR brings is ecological validity. So ecological validity is the level of similarity between the testing or the training environment with the real world, with the real life tasks that we perform in everyday life. And because of this similarity, of this high level of similarity between the testing environment and the real life task, we can predict with an augmented accuracy the everyday performance of the individual, either cognitive or behavioral. And also VR help us to solve problems like the replicability crisis, because everything is standardized and structured. That means that the other researchers or clinicians can copy and just take our VR software and replicate our methods. And of course, because VR does not demand physical presence, we can assess people or provide therapy to them in distance. So this is called telemedicine. And as I said before, we have an more accurate prediction of everyday cognitive and behavioral performance. However, to achieve these nice goals, we need to overcome some problems that come with VR. And the most important is what is called VR sickness or cyber sickness, because this kind of symptomatology actually affects and compromise our data and also minimize the level of pleasantness. Another problem is, at least it used to be, now the headsets are much cheaper. It was the cost of the headsets. So, but nowadays we have cheap solutions like the Oculus Quest, which as a headset is adequately good enough for implementation in research or clinical practices, and also a cost-effective solution. The other problem that we haven't overcome yet is the cost of the VR software development. So a VR software to be developed may cost from £5,000 until £50,000. Depends on how many levels and how many features we have inside. For several institutions, this is not affordable. So we need to find ways to not depend on third parties. So how we are going to solve all this problem? First of all, we need to have technological competency in VR technology in order to know which hardware we may use, we should use, and which software we should use as well, or how to develop the software. And to have also, we need a standardized VR software evaluation tool in order to assess both the quality of the VR software and the intensity of adverse symptomatology. And the last but not least is the software development skills. Now, a clinician or an academic has to have some software development skills in order to avoid spending so much money to third parties. So first of all, the cyber sickness symptom and why this symptomatology is so important for cognitive neuroscience and psychology in general. So the principal symptoms are nausea, dizziness, disorientation, fatigue, and disability, postural instability. So, and the negative effects are reduced overall cognitive performance. So every neuropsychological data that we have, assessment data, is compromised. Everything is compromised. Also, the presence of cyber sickness increases the body temperature and the heart rate. So that means that if we have body imaging or physiological data, then these data are compromised as well. And also is the increased brain activity of certain regions like the occipital lobe, the temporal lobe, and the frontal lobes, and the connectivity between them. So if we collect brain imaging data, then these data are compromised by this increased connectivity and activity. So in order to understand cyber sickness, we conducted a technological systematic review in order to identify the technical reasons for cyber sickness. So the most prominent reason was the quality of the headset, of the VR headset. Mainly because of low resolution, low refresh rate of the image, and a small narrow field of view. But equally important is the VR software. The VR software that contains non-ergonomic interactions or a non-ergonomic navigation system most probably will induce some cyber sickness symptoms to the participants or the patients. And the last is, again, a feature of the software, that if the software contains linear or angular accelerations, then again, we have cyber sickness. Linear acceleration is like we are in the car and the car goes so fast, so this may cause motion sickness. And angular accelerations is what we experience when we are in a roller coaster. So we identified the minimum specs that headset needs to have. Has to be times 1080.
I think there must be some problem with Anna's connection.
I think so. It's okay. He popped back pretty quick last time that happened to him.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That's weird.
Sorry, guys.
No worries. We knew you'd be back.
Okay. Just to put back my media. Okay. So where I was off?
You were just talking about resolution.
Ah, okay. So yes. Here we are. So, okay. we identified the minimum specs that we need to have. The minimum resolution per eye has to be 9060 times 1080. The refresh rate of the image has to be 75 Hz at least. But personally, I even increased this threshold to 90 Hz. Hmm. And also the field of view has to be at least 110 degrees. And the closer it is to the human field of view, approximately 180 degrees, the better. And the type of display has to be LCD or OLED. Of course, the display has to be a contemporary one, not the old LCDs. And last, the motion tracking has to be adequately fast and to be able to capture 360 degrees. So this is a summary table of the specs. And we move on to the VR software characteristics. So about the user experience, the level of immersion has to be adequate, of course. Actually, we have found that the higher level of immersion, then we have reduced also the intensity of the cybersickness of symptomatology. Are negatively correlated. Also, the VR experience has to be pleasant enough, and both the graphics and sound have to be of high quality, and or the sound, and this is really important, has to be spatialized. And as we said, a suitable hardware, so that means headset and peripherals. About the game mechanics. The navigation system has to be a suitable one, and for example, a very good in VR is a teleportation system, but the teleportation system has to be combined with the availability of physical movement, so we can both teleport ourselves and physically move within the environment. And as I said, ergonomic and naturalistic interactions. Naturalistic because the non-gamers adapt faster the controls, and we have seen that when we have a naturalistic interactions, there is no significant difference between gamers and non-gamers. And ergonomic in order to reduce the intensity of cyber sickness symptomatology. That means ergonomically to pick and hold items or use items, and to the ability to use both hands, two-handed interaction. Beyond the game mechanics, we have found that the in-game assistance is equally important, because there is this correlation between confusion and... Can you hear me, guys?
Yes. Yep.
Between confusion and cyber sickness. So by providing comprehensive and explicit tutorials, which are really helpful, and the duration has to be adequate enough in order everyone to adapt to learn the controls and everything and the goals of each task or session, assist to alleviate the cyber sickness symptomatology. Equally, we need to provide helpful in-game instructions and prompts. So that means arrows, signs, labels everywhere, or non-player characters who explain to the participant, to the patient, what they need to do and how to do it. And of course, we need to assess and report the level, the intensity of the cyber sickness symptomatology, and as I said, at least the principal symptoms. Okay, and here is a summary table of the VR software features that we need to have. Okay, and okay, just a parenthesis here. We conducted also meta-analysis, and what we have found is like almost 60% of the studies that implemented VR they had chosen an appropriate headset. And from those who indeed implemented an appropriate headset, I think it was almost 15%, they implemented a software with a non-ergonomic interaction or navigation. To be honest, the most common mistake was the navigation. So they had navigation via an Xbox controller. Anyhow, as I said, we need to have like a standardized tool in order to assess the software features, which are equally important. So we developed and validated the virtual reality neuroscience questionnaire. And the advantage of that is that assesses both the VR software quality and the VR sickness symptomatology. The disadvantage is that it doesn't contain a comprehensive, explicit assessment of every symptom related to VR sickness. An alternative is the simulator sickness questionnaire and its variants, their main advantage is that they indeed have like an extensive assessment of every symptom related to VR sickness. But the main disadvantage and the crucial one is that they don't consider and assess the characteristics of the VR software. So, because we designed the VNQ to contain both quantitative and qualitative data, we can use it and receive feedback during the development phase. And also we can conduct by using the VRQ usability and user experience studies. And also because we focus on having to reduce the administration is really short, the administration VRQ. So it doesn't take so much time to be administered. So, and also it allows the reporting of the VR software quality and of course the VR sickness symptomatology, especially for the scientific studies that these things have to be reported. And also the VRQ has some cutoff points for each section. As we said, user experience, game mechanics, in-game assistance, and the VR sickness symptomatology. And that we need to, the VR software needs at least to meet the minimum cutoffs. But if we plan to have like a long session, either assessment or therapy, then we need to use the parsimonious cutoffs which are a wee bit higher. So, as I said, another problem, and I think is the most important one at the moment, is the cost of developing a research and or clinical VR software. So, the first step that we need to do is, of course, to know if other 3D or VR applications have been, and to study them in order to get ideas at least. And of course, a deep comprehension of the theoretical framework of cognitive function that we need to study or the therapy that we are going to use. Then we need to know the target platform. So by platform, I mean the hardware. So it's different to develop something for Oculus and different for a high end like the HTC Vive Pro. And of course, we need to use to select a game engine in order to develop our software. Both Unity and Unreal are equally good. And you may use it. Personally, I prefer Unity because I'm have a better comprehension of C#, the programming language of Unity. And of course, to acquire the technical skills and the programming skills and knowledge, we can achieve that by attending online VR specializations and tutorials. There are plenty right now on the internet. Or if your institution provides, you may have like in-campus modules for learning programming for C# or C++, and this depends on which platform you are going to use. And this is really important to write as the scenario and the storyline of your software and be as explicit as possible. And by saying explicit, I mean even the smallest detail, like the flags are over there, we have a huge cube over our heads, and this kind of music, everything, every small detail. And equally, your scenario has to be detailed in order to define your scoring criteria. And the scoring criteria are equally important in assessment or in a therapy, because in therapy you need to monitor the progress of the patient. And for the scenario to reduce confusion, a good strategy is to alternate between a tutorial scene and then a subsequent storyline scene. So first to show to the participant what he/she needs to do, and then to immerse them in the storyline scene. So to build navigation interactions now in this game engines is really easy and requires minimum programming skills, because we have software development kits that provide several functions that we can use. So we need to write like a small amount of lines. So a very, very good one that I have identified and used is a virtual reality toolkit, the VRTK. But to be honest, the other SDKs are equally good. So just pick one and learn it well and use it. So, okay, I'm going to skip that. Okay, but the graphics. So another thing that, okay, because you are not 3D modelers, you don't know, or graphic designers. But the thing is that in Unity and in several websites, you may download free content and you may use this content for your VR software. And the only thing that you need to check is the number of the polygons. The same is for the sound. In order to spatialize the sound, as I said before, is really, really important to have a 360 sound. You may use an audio spatializer like Steam Audio, Oculus Audio, or any other, and all of them are free. And for the interactive characters, the same, most of the characters are free. You may download characters from Morphe Dream Xamo. And you can also find body animation or facial animations either for free or for really low cost. And okay, and here is the most important. Besides reducing the symptomatology of VR sickness, during the development we need to pay attention on these illusions. We need to provide, first of all, placement illusion. Placement illusion means that the virtual environment appears real. So mainly we rely on graphics and sound for that. And then we have the plausibility illusion. The plausibility illusion is that it is plausible that this environment is indeed real. And we achieve that by by having interactions with the virtual environment. So the environment responds, reacts to our actions. So, and this increases the plausibility illusion. Of course, this is this relies on the quality of the game mechanics and the sound or the haptics, etc. Then the embodiment illusion. As we have here, we have avatars, and we move our hands, we move our heads, and the VR avatars respond and actually imitate the our physical movements. So the better synchronization between avatar and the physical movement, the better embodiment illusion. And the and the last but not least, the temporal illusion. Temporal illusion is really, really important for long assessment sessions in VR or long rehabilitation sessions or training sessions. Because we need to give to the participant that the virtual time is actually the real time. And we can achieve that by using something like a VR watch or by animating the environmental cues, the sky, the sun, and the lighting of the environment. So, okay, we have achieved technological competency. We have a standardized VR software evaluation tool, and we know how to acquire the software development skills. And as I said, the VR methods, with VR methods, we don't have human biases. We have an automated procedure, impeccable precision, especially in timing and scoring, absolute control of the testing environment, and of course, psychological validity. So we conducted another experiment, and our VR software, which is an immersive neuropsychological battery, and we compared this battery with the traditional methods, paper pencil methods. And what we observed was that VRISE, first of all, had significantly shorter administration time. And also, we asked the participants to evaluate the pleasantness of each testing experience, and also the level of the ecological validity. So how similar is the one method and the other method to the real life task that they perform in everyday life. So the VR, of course, was far more ecological valid than the traditional methods. So we have better predictions by using VR methods. And because we have these better predictions of predictions of everyday performance, we have also a better insights on everyday cognition, and this allow us to contribute to the theoretical framework of these cognitive functions. And I think I may have missed to mention that the participants reported that the VR experience was far more pleasant than the traditional methods. And here you can see the bibliography, the studies. And here my contact details. I'm going to share the slides with you, so please contact me in any of that, and I will send the slides directly to you if you are interested. So that's all, folks. So please, questions?
Thank you, Panos.
I have a question. First of all, that was awesome. Thank you so much for sharing that information. I really enjoyed that. I just guess I wanted to make a comment. I'm the owner of a valve index, and I 144 hertz makes such a big difference for me. It's really hard to even go back to a 90 hertz headset. I can spend 4 hours in this headset, no problem whatsoever. In a Rift S, I start to get very uncomfortable. Even after 30 minutes, an hour is probably too long. It makes such a big difference from my perspective.
Okay, yeah, I have heard that from many people, and not from just for the Valve Index, but also from other high-end headsets. So thank you so much. Thanks so much. And thank you for the organizing that.
You bet.
It was great, yeah. Any more questions?
Yes, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, yeah, again, a fantastic presentation. I definitely would like a copy of your slides. And I guess I need to ask, so in terms of the VR sickness sort of thing, are you saying the low end, like in a teacher, I'm a teacher in a school, Google Cardboard is really popular, and even was starting to move towards GOES. Are you saying that those can induce VR sickness as opposed to using a Rift? I'm not sure where the specs come from, or what the specs say about that.
Yeah, it's complicated. With something like Cardboard, the most dangerous thing, anyhow, is the is the eye strain. So, because the quality of the display depends on which smartphone you are going to use, so the VR sickness symptom that you may have is like eye strain, or maybe dizziness or headache because of the eye strain. To have like nausea or an intense feeling of nausea or maybe vomiting, etc., with the cardboard is not possible, because with the cardboard you don't move in the environment. So you are like you're standing in one place and you just rotate and see the environment around. But for example, with Oculus Go, I think, yeah, you may get nauseous, but again, not so much if you spend like 10-15 minutes. We're talking about longer sessions, and keep in mind that the young ones are far more resilient in this kind of symptoms. But again, because of individual differences and different levels of resilience, you just need to keep an eye and see the reactions of the pupils.
Thank you.
You are very welcome. Another, Bill, I think, is muted there, so we don't know if he wants to ask the other Bill.
You're unmuted, Bill.
Yeah. Okay. So any other question? Anyone?
And also I have a question.
So
what's the next step? I mean, have you thought of how to apply the specific assessment software to different populations, or if you are thinking of collaborating as a university or as an individual with specific like centers that actually have the specific populations to carry out the assessment in VR? What are your future plans on that?
Okay. Difficult one, and yeah, I'm going to combine it. First of all, the VR assessment software that we have now, the duration is 60 to 70 minutes, depends on how fast the participant is, and assesses prospective memory, episodic memory, visuospatial attention, visual attention, auditory bioral attention, and executive functions such as planning and multitasking. And because this several clinical populations, they have unfortunately impairments in these cognitive functions, you can implement VRISE to several clinical populations, so like autism, early stage of dementia, individuals with mild cognitive impairments, anyone who doesn't have a mobility disability, specifically the ability to move their hands. So, because we need them to move their hands in order to perform the tasks. So, of course, we are open for collaborations, and we want to implement VR now in clinical populations. But another thing that I personally want to do is, as I said, because of the mobility, I'm looking now for other techniques to implement, for example, brain-computer interaction, or maybe an interaction by using eye tracking in order to enable other populations with motor disabilities to use VR. And also for mainly for research reasons, I want to combine VR with neuroscientific techniques, like, as I said, eye tracking and electroencephalography for brain imaging.
Great. So, yeah, that's great. As far as I know from research, I mean, around the world, very few researchers carry out research with eye tracking at the moment. Very, very few.
Just to give an information today to everybody, just in case that you want to use eye tracking and VR. And now, currently, the only solution is the SC5 Pro I, because it has embedded the eye tracking. And also, Vive provides an SDK for us. So when we develop the software, we can embed the eye tracking interaction or measurement, etc., in our software. So we have all in one. And for a cheap solution, a cheaper than Pro Eye, the Vive Cosmos, the SCC Vive Cosmos, SCC Cosmos, I don't remember the name. So we can use this software. And there is a company that even the guys from STC suggest this company that for a very small amount, they can integrate the eye tracking in STC Cosmos.
Hmm. I just wanted to comment. I just received my Pico Neo 2 with eye tracking. It also uses the Tobii eye tracking system. It's $900 for that one, and it is a mobile headset. And you can also stream from your PC. And I think that could also be a very good solution. It's very new, and I'm happy about that.
Thank you. Thank you, Chris. What's the name again?
The Pico Neo 2 I.
Okay, a resolution?
4K.
Okay, that's great. Yes. Thank you.
Yeah, that one, sorry to interrupt. I'm aware of this headset and the tracking that it's got. The thing is that it is mostly used, I think, in companies and corporate training. And
that is true.
They have recently tried to use it at schools.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, it's like a European program that they're trying to, I think it's from the VRARA Association, correct me if I'm wrong, or if there's anyone, a representative of VRARA in here, and they're trying to use the Pico Neo at schools. But up to now, I think it's been used only for corporate purposes. So that's what I'm aware of.
I'm happy with it so far, and it does have the two hand trackers using the electromagnetic tracking, so you can go off to this. It doesn't have any inside-out tracking for the hands, but it does have inside-out tracking for orientation. So,
oh, that's great. Thank you. That's another solution. Any more questions, guys? No?
Yes. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you. That was great. I really appreciated that. And I am looking forward to that slide deck as well. I thought it was awesome.
Yes. Just please send me a message and I'm going to send to everybody.
Great.
Okay. Thank you for coming.
Thank you, Panos. It's been great. Thank you. Thank you, Chris, for helping us out and being here and supporting us in all events. Bet. Thank you.
You bet. Adios, guys. I'm going to take off now. Take care.
Ciao.
Bye. See you. Mm-hmm.